began a celebration service. Walking in on the Queen of Soul, Aretha Franklin. Someone may ask the question, why walk in on the Queen of Soul? Because that was Larry's favorite singer. And the family wanted to honor him by walking in on his favorite singer. What a way to celebrate the life of this great man. And notice that I said it's a celebration. Because the program says that this is a celebration service. And when I thought about that, I looked at that word celebration. What does celebration mean? By definition, the word means festive rejoicing. And so when I thought about a funeral being a time of festive rejoicing, my mind immediately went to Charles Dickens' novel, A Tale of Two Cities. It was the best of times and it was the worst of times. And I thought about that and I said, that's really what's happening here today. It is a time of sorrow because you've lost someone that's dear to you and precious to you. We have all lost someone that's dear to us. But at the same time, it is a time of celebration. It is a time to celebrate because Larry has now been released from his mortal body that was crippled by a stroke into the loving, merciful hands of the just God of this universe who will do right by him. And so we celebrate that reality. And on today, this family is asking you to join in with them in celebrating the life of Larry Shannon Darnell Hargrove. You know, oftentimes we don't even know the names of individuals in totality. We normally just call them by their first name or we call them by their pet name. And when I read the program and I said, Larry Shannon Darnell Hargrove, I never knew he had four names. And I said, well, you know, when you have four names, that means you showed up important. And so today we've come to celebrate with this family the life of Larry Shannon Darnell Hargrove. I've been given the unenviable task as the officiant to keep the program moving. My nephew, Max, raise your hand. I know they all know you. But Max, he's just kind of taking control. Max said, I'll come here. He pulled me aside, took me over on the side, and he said, I just need to tell you this. We don't want a 4-hour funeral. So you got to keep it rolling. Make sure you keep it moving. I said, okay, nephew, I'll do the best I can to make sure we keep it moving. And so that's my charge from the family, and I'm going to do the best I can to keep it moving so that we can get this family through this service. And we want to honor them and honor their request. We want to also ask you, if you would, to take a moment to put your cell phones on silent or cut your phones off so that we don't have them going off in the midst of the service. At this time, we're going to move forward with the program. You should have a program in your possession. We're going to follow the program. I'm going to officiate the program, and I'll come back at the appropriate times. Right now, we're going to have an Old Testament scripture reading by Eric Williams, Bishop Eric Williams. And then we'll have the New Testament read by Pastor Rodney Hargrove. Are you here? All right, he'll come up and read the New Testament scripture. And one of my elders from the Church of Christ at Eastside, where Max and his family are members, Brother Ethan Williams Sr. will come up and lead our hearts in prayer. Following that, we will have a musical selection, Told You So, by Justin Hargrove. Then I'll be back with a few words of comfort to the family. At this time, we'll start the program reading of the Old Testament and New Testament scriptures.
Greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The 23rd number of Psalms. The reading beginning at the third verse. Probably the fourth verse. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff comfort me. Though thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemy, thou anointest my head with oil, my cup on it over. Then I borrowed one from the 71 passage of Psalms and says, thou shalt increase my greatness and comfort me on every side. To my family, to my cousin Margie, to all my family that are here, I just want to let you know that God is in control. He will comfort you on every side.
Greetings to my family. Our New Testament scripture reading is from the book of 1 Thessalonians, beginning with the 4th chapter and the 13th verse. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, and with the voice of the archangel, and the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. Pray that we find comfort in the word of our God.
Pray with me. Our Father and our God, we humbly approach your throne, just thanking you for who you are, the Almighty and the Everlasting. Dear Father, we ask that you would forgive us of any sin that we might have at this time, anything that would prevent you from hearing this prayer. Dear Father, at this time we come on behalf of the Hargrove family, realizing, dear Father, that the darkness comes and there's sorrow. And there will be days that the family will think upon the passing of Mr. Hargrove. And there will be dark times. But your word teaches us that sorrow may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. So, dear Father, we know that even though there will be dark times, when the morning comes and the family can reflect upon the life of Mr. Hargrove, they can remember all of the good and the examples that he has set in their lives. Dear Father, we pray for the family, all of the relatives. We pray for his siblings. We pray for his children. We pray for his grandchildren. We pray for his wife, who stood by his side, comforted him, took care of him. And we just pray a special blessing that you will be with her and just continue to strengthen her. Because we know this is a road that she hasn't traveled. And we just ask that you would lead her as she goes through life. We thank you for Mr. Hargrove. And we just know that he is in your hands, a just and loving God. Continue, dear Father, just to be with each and every one of us. Help us to always strive to do what's right and avoid that which is wrong. It is in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen.
What if this is all a dream?
the family. To the family, Margie, what a wonderful journey it has been. 42 years of marriage is a wonderful accomplishment. Let's give her a round of applause. Nowadays, people don't make it 42 weeks. Some don't make it 42 months. So you did 42 years. So that is a tremendous testimony of the relationship and the love that you had one for another. To all of the Hargrove family, all of the children, the grandchildren, the siblings, nephews and nieces, my heart is grieving with you, for you. I just want to encourage you to do what the psalmist did and said, and that great psalm of ascent, this pilgrim psalm in Psalm 121, where the psalmist said in verses 1, 2, and 3, I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills. But oftentimes we read that and we stop and we don't really understand what it's being said. The psalmist makes a declarative statement. I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills. And the next statement is an interrogative. It is a question. He says, from whence comes my, in other words, where does my help come from? Why ask such a question? Because the pagans believed that their gods dwelt in the hills. So the psalmist said, I want you to understand that I am not looking to the little g gods of the pagans who believe that their gods dwell in the hills, but I am looking to the God who actually made the hills. For he said, my help comes from the Lord, Yahweh, who made heaven and earth. He will not allow your foot to be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. So the psalmist says, I am not looking to any of these man-made idols, but I'm looking to the true and living God. And I want to encourage this family to look to the true and living God that you have leaned upon for all of these years and depended upon for your strength. Do it now. Because as the Bible says, he will not suffer you to be moved. In other words, he will be your rock of stability, and he will be your security. He will help you through this difficult time. I've been where you are. I understand that feeling. And I know that the only way I made it was by leaning on the Lord. Larry and I were friends. We often had opportunities to talk with one another. Because before Larry fell ill with the stroke, I used some of his services. He was a contractor, and I used some of his services. And I can say this, that I thoroughly, thoroughly enjoyed talking with, engaging with Larry in conversation. And I want you to know that Larry could talk as long as you could listen. And I promise you this, you would run out of listening before he ran out of talking. Whenever we would talk, we would share so much, you know, because you would look at Larry, you wouldn't think that Larry had all of that stuff going on in his head. But he was somewhat of a quasi-philosopher. And I read the program, it said something like a preacher and a lawyer. But I remember some of the conversations we would have, and you know, I'd listen long enough and listen, and I would talk some, but Larry did most of the talking. And then finally, Larry knew he had to let me go. He said, well, Brother Williams, I know you got to go, so I'm going to let you go. And I said, yeah, Larry, I got to go. I really do have to go. And whenever Larry said, I'm going to let you go, that did not mean immediately. It meant that I'm trying to let you go. And so what I found would happen is that oftentimes I would start leaving, and Larry said, well, but before you go, I just need to say one more thing. I said, all right, Larry, what is it? And he would tell me what's on his heart. And oftentimes we've been talking about politics. Politics was one of his favorite subjects. And he loved to talk about it. And he wasn't just talking jive. He wasn't just talking trash. He wasn't just talking hearsay. Larry was knowledgeable. And he was giving words of wisdom. Wasn't talking foolishness. Larry was a man who knew what he was talking about and who had an agenda to try to make a difference in this world. And so I just want to say to you that your dad, whoever he was to you, whatever he was to you, he was a great man. And not only was he a great man, but he was a good man. And I loved Larry. And not only did I love Larry, I liked Larry. You see, some people, you can love them, but they're difficult to like. Say amen if you can. I think all of us know some folk like that. You love them unconditionally, but they're difficult people to like. But I loved Larry and I liked Larry. I loved Larry with an agape love, that unconditional love that simply says, I always want what is in your best interest. But I also loved Larry with a phileo love, that is that friendship love, that love that says, I'm fond of you. I enjoy your company. I enjoy being around you. And then I loved him with that storge love, which is to say he was my family. He's a part of my family. And so I loved Larry on every level relative to that, agape, phileo, and storge. I want to give you just a few words from the Word of God before I go back to my seat. As I thought about what to say, I'm not here to eulogize. I'm just giving you a few words of comfort that I hope you can carry with you when you leave here. In Matthew chapter 22, there's an interesting encounter going on with Jesus and the Sadducees. In Matthew chapter 22, beginning at verse number 23, I'm not going to read the text, but I will allude to the text, and you will remember the story, that the Sadducees came to test Jesus and to try Jesus. And so they came to him with this fictitious hypothetical story, because they did not believe in the resurrection. And so they came to Jesus and they said, now Jesus, here is the scenario. There was a woman and a brother, a man that had seven brothers, there were seven of them. And the legal right law says that if a man marries a woman and he dies before he leaves any children, that the next brother in line is to marry that woman and give children to his name. And so they went through this litany of things and said, well, now, there were seven brothers, and all seven of them had this woman. And they all died. You know, when I read that, I said, you know, that's hypothetical. Because number one, if I was number seven, I would not have married her. If she'd have killed all six. Amen. But understand this. Understand, it was a hypothetical situation. And they're trying to trap Jesus. And so they said, now Jesus, in the resurrection, whose wife will she be, since all seven of them were married to her? Now if there is a resurrection, then there's a mess, because all of them will be squabbling and fighting over this one woman. And Jesus said in verse number 31, watch this, verse 29 of Matthew chapter 22, Jesus replied, he says, you are in error because you do not know the scriptures or the power of God. At the resurrection, people will neither marry nor be given in marriage. They will be like the angels in heaven. But about the resurrection of the dead, have you not read what God said to you? And then he says in verse number 32, I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. He is not the God of the dead, but of the living. In this text, Jesus tells us at least three things about death. I will be very brief. Very brief. First of all, he tells us that death is not the end of us. He tells us that death is not the end. It is not the period in the sentence of life, but rather death is the comma in the sentence of life. How do I know that? Listen to what he says. When God first chapter 3, when Moses was approaching the burning bush, in verse number 6, God spoke from that bush, and God said, I am the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. Notice this now. He said, I am the God of Abraham. I am the God of Isaac. I am the God of Jacob. But when God said that in Exodus chapter 3, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob had long been dead. Abraham had been dead for 329 years. Isaac had been dead for 224 years. And Jacob had been dead for 198 years. Yet God said, I am speaking in the present tense, not the past tense. He did not say, I was the God. I used to be the God. He said, I am the God of Abraham. I am the God of Isaac. I am the God of Jacob. He said, I am present tense right now at this present very time, this very moment, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. What is God trying to tell us? By using the present tense instead of the past tense, God emphatically stated in an unambiguous, with unambiguous clarity, that these patriarchs were still alive and well in the land of the living. Stay with me now. Family, brothers and sisters, Larry is still very much alive in the land of the living. You might say, well, Brother Williams, didn't you make a mistake? You said the land of the living. Larry's in the land of the dead. No, sir, no, ma'am. You need to understand that we are in the land of the dying. But Larry has transitioned from the land of the dying into the land of the living. He's through with dying. We still have to deal with dying. So Larry has transitioned from this side where all of us yet must meet this fate. But now he's in that land of the living. Secondly, in Matthew 22 and verse number 32, it teaches us that when our loved ones die, they don't cease to be who they were over here. In other words, they don't lose their personality and they don't lose their identity. Notice what God said. He said, I am the God of Abraham. I am the God of Isaac. I am the God of Jacob. In other words, Abraham was still Abraham, Isaac was still Isaac, and Jacob was still Jacob. Even though they had transitioned from this side to the other side, they were still who they were on this side. And Larry is still who he was on this side, on the other side. The Larry that you knew and loved is still Larry. He's still that Larry that you knew and loved over here. He has simply changed from one glory to another glory, and the final and ultimate glory is yet to come. Lastly, Matthew 22 and verse number 32 teaches us that death does not have the final say. God does. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 22 and verse number 31, but about the resurrection of the dead, have you not read what God said to you? Jesus said that the grave does not have the final say. The grave does not have the final victory. God does. And I know that God does because Jesus is alive. Can you say amen to that? How many of y'all believe that Jesus is alive? But since Jesus is alive, then we know that the grave does not have the final say. Because Jesus is alive, he robbed the grave of its power and of its victory. And because he got up, he promised us that we too shall get up. That's what Paul said. Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 20 through 23, but now Christ is risen from the dead and has become, notice this, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since by man came death, by man also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all died, even so in Christ all shall be made alive. That expression, first fruits, is an agrarian metaphor. In other words, he is simply saying, watch this now, that the living Christ is living proof that there is a bumper crop coming after him. Hallelujah. The grave does not have the final say. Christ does. One day the voice of Christ will empty every grave. Because the Bible says in John chapter 5 verses 28 and 29, everyone, Jesus said, everyone in the grave will hear his voice and come forth. Those who have done evil unto the resurrection of condemnation, but those who have done righteous unto the resurrection of eternal life. Family, take consolation in the reality that Larry is still alive, Larry is still living, Larry is still Larry, and the grave does not have the final say. God does. And so I will say to the family today, God bless you, and I pray that those words will give you some consolation. And I want to challenge all of us to just get ready for that day, because our day will come. Romans 10, 9 and 10, if you believe in your heart that Jesus Christ has risen from the dead and confess with your mouth, you shall be saved. But then Mark 16, 15 says, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. There is no contradiction. The Bible is right. You must believe. You must repent. You must confess. And you must be baptized. And when you do that, God saves you by his grace. And he adds you to his glorious body. And the day will come that you will hear his marvelous voice and come forth. Bless your hearts. Bless your hearts. Larry did his part, and he's in the hands of our loving, just, and wonderful God. And God will do with him what is right to do. I pray that you'll take that with you and let your hearts be comforted with that. At this time, we will have a video presentation. And after that, I'll come back. There will be selected reflections, and I'll have the names of the individuals, and I will call their names and have them to come forward. And of course, the family has asked you to keep your comments to 3 minutes. I know that's tough, but I will do my best to try to hold you to that. God bless each and every one of you. I love you, family. Continue to pray for you, and want you to know that we're here for you.
From Austin, Texas, won't you give a big round of applause for the start of the show? Won't you give it up for Larry Hargrove, y'all?
For my son, Corey Adrian O'Neill Hargrove. He's got to be my greatest fan. You know, I got to tell you a story right now. I played professional music most of all of my life. My daddy started me singing when I was 5 years old in church. I'll never forget the first song he taught me. And I have many recordings of my professional life. And my son looks at them all the time, and he said, Dad, I want you to sing again for me. He said, I like those tapes. He said, I want to sing just like you. So I say, son, well, the 19th of June committee asked me if I would do a show at Downsville for the 19th of June. If you'd like to sing, son, I'll take you with me, because I could never forget that first time my daddy put me on stage. Well, Dad's not with us anymore. Oh, but I treasure memories. And I said, someday when I'm dead and gone, he'll never forget this night. Would you please put your hands together for the first generation of Hargroves? This is Corey, Agent O'Neill Hargrove.
Would you please give him a big round of applause as he approaches the bandstand? This is Little James Brown.
Introducing the world's greatest entertainer, Mr. Dynamite, the amazing Mr. Please Please himself, the hardest working man in show business. Ladies and gentlemen, the star of the show, James Brown!
He's always ready to lend his time and his talents, and he has received several awards for his involvement with programs in the Austin Independent School District. So I'm happy today to proclaim and state, be it known by these presents, that I, Kirk Watson, Mayor of the City of Austin, Texas, do hereby proclaim January 7th, 1999 as Larry Shannon Hargrove Day in Austin. And I call on all citizens to join me in recognizing the many outstanding contributions by the local community music community toward the development of Austin's social, economic, and cultural diversity, and in recognizing the dedicated efforts of artists which further Austin's status as the live music capital of the world. And signed by me, Kirk Watson, Mayor of the City of Austin, ladies and gentlemen, Larry Shannon Hargrove.
Mayor,
there you go.
Thank you very much.
Sure.
This is a great honor. And I'm going to do a song that's close and dear to me. It's a song called Patches. It's on my new CD also, and we'd like to invite you all to pick it up. It just reminds me of my time with my father, and my father's no longer with us anymore. So y'all bear with me, and I'm going to sing Patches for you. I was born in Manor, Texas, on a farm way back up in the woods. I was so ragged that folks used to call me Patches. My daddy teased me about it, but deep down inside, he was hurt because he done the best he could, you see. My papa was a great old man. I can see him with the shovel in his hand, you see. Education he never had, but he did wonders when the times got bad. The little money from the crops we raised barely paid the bills we made. Oh, life would kick him down to the ground, and when he got us, life would kick him back down. One day, my daddy called me to his dying bed, put his hands on my shoulder with tears. He said, Patches, I'm depending on you, son, to pull the family through. My son is all left up to you. Well, 2 days later, my daddy passed away, and I guess I became a man that day. So I told Mama that I was going to quit school, but she said, no, Larry, that would be against Papa's fitness rule. So every morning I went to school. I fed the chickens and I chopped wood too. Sometimes I felt like I couldn't go on. I wanted to leave, just run away from home. But I would remember what my daddy said, with tears in his eyes on his dying bed. He said, Patches, I'm depending on you, son, to prove. Strong rain came and it washed all the crops away. And at the tender age of 13, I felt like I was carrying the weight of the whole world upon my shoulder. But my mama knew what I was going through because, you see, every day I had to work the fields, because that's the only way we got our meals. You see, I was the oldest of the family, and everybody was depending on me. And every night I heard my mama pray, boy's strength to make another day. Though the years have passed, the kids have grown, the angels took my mama to a brand new home. Lord knows, people, I shed in my tears, but my daddy's voice kept ringing in my ears. He said, Patches, I'm depending on you, son, to pull the family through. My son is all left up to you. I kept on hearing my daddy say, Patches, I'm depending on you, son. I tried to do my best. It's up to you, Larry. You gotta do the best. Yeah. Woo. He said, Patches, I'm depending on nobody but you, boy.
I kept on hearing my daddy say, I'm depending on nobody but you. Thank you, I'm Larry Hargrove.
Thank you, Larry. Where will you be performing next?
Well, Mayor, I'm getting ready to go on a short tour. As this song has been, let me see what the CD.
Yeah, show CD.
As this song has gotten national attention, and it's been all in the news. I was interviewed recently by the NBC News in Washington, D.C. And this is the CD called Leave Bill Clinton Alone. And I'm just humbled by the whole experience. So many articles have been written. I just want to thank all the radio stations that are playing this song all over the country. I've received phone calls from as far away as Australia, Anchorage, Alaska, and Canada. I've done over 300 on-air radio interviews, and I'm glad to say that I got a phone call from the President of the United States himself.
Yeah. Thank you for being with us today.
Sure. This is at Waterloo Records and Music Mania. Leave Bill Clinton alone. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Larry.
I never that there would be warm love in springtime. That is when you started to be cold. I never dreamed you'd leave in summer, but now I find myself all alone. You said then you'd be the life in autumn. Said
I'm certain I've lived a life that's full. I traveled each and every highway and more, much more than this. I did it my way. Regrets I've had a few, but then again, too few to mention. I did what I had to do, and saw it through without exemption. I planned each charted course, each careful step along the byway, and more, much more than this, I did it my way. Yes, there were times, I'm sure you knew, when I bit off more than I could chew, but through it all, when there was doubt, I ate it up and spit it out. I faced it all and I stood tall and did it my way. I've loved, I've laughed and cried, I've had my fill, my share of losing, and now as tears subside, I find it all so amusing to think I did all that, and may I say, not in a shy way. Oh no, not me, I did it my way. Yes, there were times, I'm sure you knew, when I bit off more than I could chew. But through it all, when there was doubt, I ate it up and spit it out. I faced it all and I stood tall and did it my way. I've loved, I've laughed and cried, I've had my fill, my share of losing, and now, as tears subside, I find it all so amusing to think I did all that, and may I say, not in a shy way. Oh no, not me. I did it my way. For what is a man? What has he got? If not himself, then he has not to say.
Sydney, Trent Robinson. Please come forward, and we're going to ask that you please adhere to the 3 minutes, and I'm going to do my best to stay seated, but if you get a little too long, I'll stand up. All right? So we're going to have at this time Ethan and Iris Williams, they'll come forward, and then Whitney Barlow, Scott Reynolds, Dexter Walker, Billy Carr, and Ed Davis, Sherelle Sidney, Trent Robinson. That's the way they're listed here, and that is the way I assume they will proceed. Thank you. God bless you.
My name is Samara Williams, and I'm married to Marjorie Larry. They are my mom and pops, as I affectionately call them. Son Max, and these are my parents, Ethan and Iris, and they were on program, as Mr. Brown would say, to speak about Pops, who was their good friend. God not only blessed me with amazing parents, but he also saw fit to bless Max and I with incredible in-laws on both sides. Max and I have been married for 13 years, but have been together for over 20 years now, which is 20 years that I've been a part of the Hargrove family. Though it feels like more of a blessing than I deserve. Our union is special in the fact that each of our in-laws have not only treated us like their own kids from the beginning, but also go a step further to treat one another like siblings, great friends, even to the point that we can enjoy holidays together and events together. They even talk to one another and support one another outside of Max and leave us out sometimes. That said, though Mama, my husband, and siblings didn't know I was going to come up here, my mom and dad graciously allowed me to take their place on program today because I knew my husband and siblings would never be able to get up here and get through speaking about Pops without being overcome with emotion. But I could not just allow Pops' kids and Mama to go underrepresented. Besides, Pops never missed an opportunity to sing at these kind of things, whether he was on program or not. So it seemed appropriate that I should pencil myself in. I thought I was the least emotionally inclined of the group, but I'm gonna try my best to speak briefly on Pops, who he was to us and his love. I've asked my parents to stay up here with me, not only to help me get through this, but because, and this is full disclaimer, even though I'm a middle school teacher and stand confidently in front of my students, I'm usually not allowed by certain family members to speak of these sort of things in front of adults, because as introverted as I am, sometimes that comes with some weird tendencies, which I hope you don't get a demonstration of today. But to Mama, I couldn't ask for a better mother-in-law and a better father-in-law. You and Pops have always treated me like a daughter, as you have set an amazing example. We're accepting who your children love. It's your own rules. And I pray that I will be able to show you in a fraction of that love that y'all show me to my future daughter-in-laws. Mama, the fact that you're sitting here and not laid up somewhere in an asylum after losing your better half speaks volumes about the quiet strength that I have always admired in you, a strength that Pops depended on, whether it was working routes side by side with him in the buildings in the wee hours of the morning, raising those beautiful children, or putting up with his hoarding tendencies. He loved you to the point that even in the end, physical separation from you was unbearable, even if it was just you walking out to the car to bring your groceries. When you need to feel close to Pops, you have but to look at your children and your grandchildren and know who you know are so much like him in their own way. The unconditional love you have and he have for your family and that the family has for you and God's love is what will get you through this darkest of times. 40. Being the oldest girl in my own family, gaining you as an in-law was a major bonus since I finally got to have a big sister. And what an amazing sister you are. Your drive, determination, and hustle to better yourself and your family's lives, and your giving nature is not only inspiring, but it's a clear manifestation of who Pops was and the example that he set for you and the family. He was so proud of your every accomplishment and was especially proud of the mother that you are. Lauren and Yana, your Poppy loved you so much. And when you look at how hard your mom works and how much of a boss lady she is, just know that you are looking at some of the best pieces of your Poppy. Trent, I know in your grief, you can also attest to the being welcome and accepted with open arms mentality that Mom and Pops have shown us, even after being initiated into the family with Pops' epic fall down the bleachers when he was at Max's college football game. But I hope you also recognize that you too share some of Pops' greatest qualities because Courtney chose you to be her partner. Courtney, like Mama, you have but to look at your husband and daughter's wanting to feel a little closer to Pops. Corey, thank you for being my bro. Like me, your siblings, your children, and your nieces and nephews, I know Pop felt secure in knowing that if anyone messed with any of us, they'd have to deal with you. And somehow you always show up on time. Pops could always count on you to drive the cars or work the buildings, even when he wasn't able to do so himself. And you especially remind me most of him when you get to philosophizing or sharing random facts. He was proud of you and he loved you and your kids. Hold on to that knowledge in days to come. Simone and little Corey, you may be too young to understand everything that has happened, but Poppy loves you, and I know your daddy will make sure that you never forget him. I'm Bree. My niece, I know the loss of Poppy hurts so much, whether it was enjoying your musical talents in concerts or watching you graduate, go to college, and enter the workforce. Just know your Poppy loved you and was so proud of you. I'm J-U-S-T-O-N, my brosive. Though we had a bit of a rocky start due to your rivalry for Max's time, I know now that being the true baby in the family, you just didn't like to share. Not your condiments at restaurants, and certainly not your bro time. Like I care. Real talk, I don't know what the family would do without you. And I value the relationship we have and the fact that I gained a little but bigger than me brother and a friend in uniting with Max. The peace of mind that comes with knowing you always have Mom and Pops covered is priceless. And I'm so grateful that Max has you to lean on and be open with. Even if you did inspire him to pick to play the guitar all hours of the night when the kids and I are trying to sleep. The sacrifice and love you show towards the family is the clear manifestation of who Pops was. He lives through you every day. And if you need more proof, look at who you are as a musician. In addition to your crazy drive and temperament, you clearly inherited Pop's musical ability. How many people can say that they have recorded music with their father? Another priceless experience that I know you will cherish. Pop's is so very proud of you and thankful for you. Bask in that knowledge and let it fill you up in the days to come. Maxie. My husband, my friend, I know losing Pops was one of your worst fears and nightmares, that you're forever changed. Just know that he'll never be gone from you. You have to look in the mirror and reflect on what a good husband, what an amazing father you are. To see him and to know that you're living proof of the example that your dad set for you. Your grind, your determination, charisma, as well as your hoarding tendencies, and your tendency to be extra are clearly inherited from Pops. He valued your opinions and advice, admired the man and father that you have become, and was so proud to call you his son. Just look at our sons and the relationship with them and the example you set for them to know I speak only the truth. MJ, Jalen, Davion, my sweet boys, I know your Poppy loves you and was so proud of you and your accomplishments in school on the field in your relationship with God. Continue to make him proud and take comfort in knowing that he lives through you and your family. And to Pops, thank you for being what your family needed, for all your sacrifice, hard work, commitment, and for being the best father-in-law a girl could ask for. The way your children look out for one another and Mama is a direct result of the example that you set. Though you left a load of ice cream in your fridge behind for the boys in true Poppy fashion, I gladly let them binge on it for once in exchange for one last conversation with you. I will miss the laughs, trying to keep you from acting up, and the fact that you could always be counted on to hover and be watchful over the boys even more than me. I'm forever grateful to you and Mama for bringing Max into this world, and though you're gone, I'm sure there's a new star in the sky that's shining as bright as your personality, coupled with one of your suits. Know that I look forward to finding an outfit to match the bling cowgirl's hat that you got me. You're gone but never forgotten. I miss you, Pops, and I love you.
With this celebration of Larry and Shannon Hargrove. My name is Whitney Barlow, and I'm a speech therapist with a home health agency. So my normal job consists of going into people's homes and providing therapy for things like speech, language, voice, memory. I see about 30 different people each week, but in the past few months, since I started seeing Mr. Larry, he became my favorite to see. Every time I stepped into Larry and Margie's home, I was always greeted with a big smile and questions about how I was doing and how my day was going. Larry was consistently thoughtful, kind, and motivated. Larry's main goal in working with me was to get his million-dollar voice back, and he worked very hard to do that. The best way to practice speech is to practice talking about the things that you love. So Larry and I spent a lot of time talking about music and his family. One time, I asked Larry how he ends a conversation, like what he would tell somebody when he was saying goodbye to them. He told me that he would say, "Be safe out there." To me, that answer demonstrated his thought for others and his caring spirit. His ideal parting wish would always be for the safety and well-being of others. I am so thankful for the time that I got to spend with Larry, and I feel your loss deeply for such a great man. I appreciate you all letting me take the time to honor him in this way. I hope for comfort and peace in the coming time. And I believe people live on in the way that we remember them. So Larry will be in my mind, as will you all. Be safe out there.
Hello, everybody. My name is Scott Runnels, and I've worked with Larry for 25 years in the recording industry. I recorded his voice for a long, long time. When I first met Larry, this was starting in the digital age. We're moving from tapes to digital, and we lost a section of his song. And he's like, "Scott, you know everything I do is of historical importance." I kind of didn't know what he was talking about, and I did have to answer, say, "Well, I'm sorry, because this take here is just history." But I didn't understand what he was talking about. I mean, I knew he'd been around, I knew he'd sang a lot. And the more I worked with him, the more I understood the importance that he had in the industry, in music, in life. He told a great story in words through music. And, I've watched him from 25 years to where he was, to where he is. And after stroke, he did come in with his million-dollar voice, and we came close. We came so close. He was trying so hard, and it was such a pleasure for me to be able to work with him, not just for the 25 years, but to help him in his recovery. And because when he walks in that studio, his eyes just light up. He just becomes the happiest person in the world. And I'm not saying that he's not happy when he's with his family, but that's what I got to see. And, you know, he had a huge personality. He had a huge ego. He had a huge voice, a huge heart, and a huge soul. And I know that Larry Shannon Hargrove will definitely be inducted into the Texas Hall of Fame for music. And we will get that started because he is his stamp in the music industry, the stamp of Austin, Texas, and I can say the music in general will be truly missed. But the fact that we have recorded versions of Larry, his legacy will live on forever. I listen to him every day. He's in my playlist. So God rest and God bless. And thank you for the honor of letting me speak on his behalf. Thank you.
Anything. See, what Courtney didn't know is I worked my way all the way out of the special specialty class into the honors class, and I struggled with my identity for a long time. Baby, but when you stepped foot, was it Manor Street, Courtney? Baby, when you stepped foot into that mansion they had back in 1996? Telling on us, baby, I'm sorry, telling on us. But when I stepped into that mansion, baby, when I tell you Margie and Larry gave me enough self-esteem to bless this audience, please know this, he is absent from the body, but he's present with the Lord. I am super excited and delighted, and I'm gonna get ready to take my seat. But I said to myself, I said, if Larry were here, what would he ask? He would say, Sherelle, you better tell them, you better remember me. You remember his legacy, you tell those kids. Because listen, they are from a royal priesthood. You remember the love that he gave, and make sure that you love on folks like nobody's business. This is probably about the fifth funeral that I've been to in the last 90 days. So please love on your family. And if nothing else, you better live life to the fullest. You better live every single day as if it were your last, because you don't know when your last is. Praises unto God. Praises unto God. I thank you so much, Hargrove family, for allowing me to come. God bless you. If you need me, I'm here. I will bless and I will gas up that Ford Escape, and we're going to make it work. Amen, everybody.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
I wish I would have went before her. To be honest with you. Real talk. So I have to do this a little bit upbeat. I'm not going to match that, sister, but I have to do that in order to keep myself from becoming emotional. And believe it or not, when I become emotional, this actually gets uglier. So to bless everybody here, I'm going to keep it upbeat. Is that all right? So I hold a distinction, and I'm probably not the only one, but I hold the distinction of meeting both former President Bill Clinton and Larry Shannon Hargrove. Meeting Brother Hargrove was a bigger deal. I just have to tell you. Because of this reason, Bill Clinton was just the President of the United States. That's all he was. Brother Hargrove was the Texas Songbird. And for a young black man like me, coming up in Austin, Travis County, Texas, you just know about things. You know about Lady Bird Lake. You just gotta know it. Whether you've been there or not, you know about the Texas Capitol. You know about Dallas Field. You know about Gibbons Park. You know about the landscapes. You know about the fixtures of this place. Larry Shannon Hargrove, the Texas Songbird, was one of those fixtures. Now, I gotta be honest with you, at the time I didn't understand what that meant. Brother Hargrove, to me that was blues. I wasn't a blues dude, Trent. I wasn't blues. I was hip hop, baby. I didn't try to study no blues. So I put it on the shelf. I didn't respect that. Although I'd drive by Loyola and I would see that mansion. And long before I had a chance to meet him, I would refer to it affectionately as the Falcon Crest. Anybody old enough to remember that show? That was Falcon Crest to me. So as it would happen, some friends and I had a chance encounter meeting with a group of young ladies in San Marcos, Texas. Now, I gotta tell the truth and shame the devil, because I'm in the house of the Lord. My friends and I are just minding our own business, eating, and we hear a commotion at a table. A bunch of young ladies enjoying the day. Lo and behold, it turns out that it's somebody's birthday over there. And the folks in the Chili's or whatever the restaurant was, they're bringing the cake over and they're celebrating. My buddies and I, we decide, you know what? Let's go over and bless the sister with a birthday song. So we think we can sing a little bit, wobble. We go over and we sing like happy birthday. And as we were leaving, you know, we blessed her again. And that's when Courtney leaned in and said, well, it's not really my birthday. We just do this to get free cake. Do this. Not did this. Do this. Player, this is what we do. We get free cake. We take folks for their cake. That's how we get there. I don't know how I felt about that, minister. See, I was rolling with preachers and deacons at that time. I was trying to live right. I didn't know how to act. But if anybody knows the father, they have to know the rest of the family. You can't be around something this spectacular and electric without being electric yourself. And so, in no time flat, Courtney became our little sister. And because of that chance encounter, which I thank God for, I had the chance to finally meet the Texas songbird. Now, the way that went down, she invited us to her graduation at Texas State. I'm younger than the other sister. Texas State. And I'm in the reception area, and I'm enjoying this luscious plate of fruit. And I opened my eyes, and the doors opened, and it was almost as if it was a lights, camera, action scenario. And I see this figure walk in the room, and I cannot take my eyes off. It was, how do I describe it? The suit alone. I had never seen a suit like that in my life. He was gold trimmed from almost head to toe. And Brother Minister, some people walk and some people, you know, stammer. This brother sort of glided into the room. And I'm in there, I still have the fruit in my hand and I have to stop eating because who is this man? And it wasn't pompous at all. He didn't walk in like he owned the place. But understand me, he walked in like if that place was for sale, he could buy it. If that makes any sense to you. That's the aura that I got from this man. Well, soon enough, he embraced Courtney and she introduced, and I realized who it was, but I sort of flubbed the introduction because, now y'all know Brother Hargrove, y'all know how he did. He was tight, he was late. And not only had I not seen a suit like that, but I had never seen a brooch. Y'all know which one I'm talking about. To this day, I don't know if it was a gecko or a lizard or I don't know. I'm not that smart, but as I was being introduced, I'm not gonna swear in church, but I have a feeling that the tail moved. And I was determined to watch it move again, so I was focused on it. So I messed up the introduction. Later on, back at the fruit stand, I had a chance to talk to him on my own, and I said, well, this is my friend's father, and I'd heard so much about him. He's basically a living legend, but let me talk to this man. So, you know, I think I'm kind of slick. I think I got some good words and some, you know, triple vowels and syllables. Let me talk to this man. So I know he's a music guy. So I talked to him about his music. Okay? Understand what I said. I'm not a blues guy. So I'm faking it. I'm faking it. I don't know I'm faking it. He looks up at me, and I can tell you the first five words this man ever said to me in a private conversation. After I'm talking, I'm talking to him about his music now. The first five words he ever said to me. Do you want a CD? I ain't blues, baby. I'm hip-hop. So in the back of my mind, I'm thinking, I don't want a CD. So I'm like, I'm going to Jedi mind trick the brother. So we're going to talk about some different things. I'm going to get him off the CD situation. And, you know, we're going to call it a day. It's all good. So, of course, what I get to talk to him about? Politics, philosophy. I didn't know. I had no idea. Nobody warned me. Nobody warned me. But the more we talked, and the more I learned, the more I liked him. more I liked them, the more we talked, the more I learned, the closer we got to that door. The closer we got to that door, the more we talked, the more I liked them, the more I learned, and the closer we got to that car. So now, after all this talking and all this walking, I'm faced with two questions that are going to change my life. Number one, do I still support the down-ballot Democratic ticket? And number two, was I going to buy two CDs or three? I ain't no punk, you understand me? I'm from the streets, so I looked at him square eye and I said, I'll take two, please. I've come to understand that that interaction wasn't a hustle. And even if it was, there's no shame in it, because the man hustled, and he hustled for the right reasons. But what he was doing was he was spending time with me, and he was sharing with me. Over the years, I got a chance to develop a deeper relationship with him in the strangest of ways, over the air. We would both call in to the radio program, KZI. And again, I'm thinking I'm slick, I'm talking that stuff. And I thought I did all right. But then I would hear him call in, and I would hear the words coming out of his mouth. And they were never vain, and they were never puffed up. It was always short and sweet and to the point. And I knew that something wise was about to be said when he said this. You know, I've been reading the tea leaves. Whenever he said that, I perked up and I would listen. Soon after that, he wasn't the songbird anymore to me. I gave him the nickname, the Oracle. Like you said earlier, the man had deep philosophy. And no matter what subject we were talking about, whether it was geopolitical, social, economic, or family, I learned so much from that man. One of the best pieces of advice I've ever gotten from my mother, she said, son, submit yourself at the feet of the wise, and you will always be blessed. And I thank her for that. I had no problem submitting myself to Brother Shannon, because his words were always wise, and his heart was always in the right place. No matter where this man had gone in life, no matter who he had been with, he's traveled all over. But when he and I engaged in a conversation, I felt like I was the most important person. We were blessed to have our families unite when Trent and Courtney had their children, and we would bring our children to the birthday parties. And that's when I really got to know Larry Shannon Hargrove, the man. He had far surpassed the legend. He had far surpassed the oracle. I got a chance to really get close to the brother. And he was just that, a good, good brother. And I've already wished him in my heart a peaceful journey. So in closing, I would just say to the family, and I mean this most sincerely, thank you for sharing this man with the world. Thank you for sharing his talents with our nation. thank you for sharing this time with me. Listening to the prior speakers, all I can say is, wow. I feel somewhat inadequate at this time to have apologized to many speakers, but I've been asked by the family to say a few words because I know this family quite well. And I'm relieved that my ministry has allowed those speakers to go a little bit over 3 minutes. But see, he's probably not going to let me do that because he knows me. And he's not going to hesitate to get up. But Brother Williams, I'm going to let you know when to start. My wife and I came to Austin, it has to be 44 years now because that's how long we've been married. And I met Larry and Margie by way of my employer. I worked for Louise's cafeteria.
Oh, yeah.
And every Sunday, about 1:30, 1:45, St. James would show up. And the reason why you know it was St. James is because they would announce themselves. St. James is in the house. And 1:30, sometimes 2 o'clock, they would have long service. Their preacher was a lot like my preacher. A little bit long-winded. Y'all know what I'm talking about, Dr. Franklin. Yeah, y'all know. And so they would come about that time, and then Larry would bring his family with him. And as been said, Larry would, after he got to know me, and I think what he did, because I never remember introducing myself to Larry, but Larry, no doubt, probably got with an employee and said, who is that black guy standing behind the camera with a white shirt and a tie on? And I'm quite sure somebody said, well, that's Mr. Davis. And we at that time, Louise was a very conservative company, and they said, you lose your first name, your name is Mr. Davis. I don't care if you're talking to an employee, been working for us 30 years, they don't call you Mr. Davis. So Larry always called me Mr. Davis. And Margie, even yesterday when I came in and saw her, she called me Mr. Davis. That's what they called me. They didn't know I had a name, Ed. But Larry would always tell me, you know, you're the first black guy I've seen in management. And I said, well, that's a good reason for that, because by now I'm the only one. And I said, I was the first one. And Larry would always say, man, I'm proud of you. I'm so proud of you, man. And he would encourage me over and over again, you can make it, man. You can do this. I'm so proud of you. And that helped me, because I was young, and I needed that encouragement. But what he didn't know was that I would go home every night after standing on my feet 14, 15 hours a day, soak my feet in a tub of hot water and Epsom salt, and ask my wife to go get the newspaper because I want to see the want ads. And I would look in the want ads, and I said, nah, I guess I'll go back to work. But Larry would come in with the St. James group, and Larry would want to talk the whole way through the line. From the Senate County, he would start talking. And so to keep the line moving, I would just move side by side with him like this. Because he wanted to talk. And sometimes Martin would say, Larry, go ahead and get your order. People are waiting on you. The St. James people would be mad at Larry because they wanted to eat.
because Dr. Franklin had kept us here a long time. Larry kicked on. So we keep going. Salads, meats, vegetables. And along the way, we would stop at the dessert counter. And I would hear a little voice, a female voice, say something like this. I want a strawberry shortcake. I want a strawberry shortcake. Can I get a strawberry shortcake? And I believe her name was Courtney. Well, yeah, Courtney. You remember the strawberry shortcake? And so, you know how mamas are. I don't know whether you should get a strawberry shortcake or not, Courtney, because you don't eat up all your food. You need to eat your food. I'll let you know if you can have a strawberry shortcake. But you know, Larry, being like most of us men, especially with daughters, this is Larry. Here, baby. He put that shortcake on that tray, and then Margie would give him the look. Y'all know what the look is. Because I've seen that look for 44 years. And that look simply says, okay, mister, you showing out. I'm not going to show out right now because it's a public place. You don't want me to show out here, Larry. But when I get home, I'm going to show out on you and Courtney. So anyway, Courtney got a shortcake. Let me forewind a little bit. That's anything else I can say, but maybe I'm going to say 22, 23, 24 years later. And we talked all along then because wherever I went to Louis, Larry was sure. When I went to Steak and Mopac, they found me there. When I went to Cameron Road, 183, when it moved out of the mall, it was in the mall for 20 years. When it moved out of the mall and I went and was the manager there, that was, we called that the country club of the East Side, especially Sunday afternoon. Because that's when all you folks would just turn it out. And so, about 23, 24 years later, I'm in Roundup, and us and Larry and Margie was right in front of me, and they knew I was by myself, so they said, why don't you come join us? And I said, that'll be fine. So I'm sitting there with Larry and Margie, and Larry said, you know, my son is dating one of y'all's girls at your church. Really? I said, who's that? He said, Samara Williams. Yeah, Samara Williams, yeah, she's just like a daughter, man. He said, yeah, my son. And I got to thinking, she has been bringing some little short cool dude to Bible class. I said, you talking about, they call him Max. Yeah, that's our son. I said, yeah, I see him. He done sneaked through here and stole one of our girls. That all the teenage boys mad. I'm not going to go over that anymore. But they said, you know, do you remember when you were at Lewis and this was Larry talking and Margie got sick and I told you that I needed an EMS because my wife is sick. She's pregnant. He said, you need to call 911. So I called 911 to get her some assistance. And Mark said, that was Max. That was Max? She said, that was Max. Max was ready to come out. And I'm thinking, wow. That was, and I said, wow, you know, who would have ever thought that? And I mentioned that to Max, and we talked about it even today. But that was quite an ordeal because Margie didn't get a chance to finish her Luann platter because Max, little Max, was ready to come out. Courtney was mad because she didn't get a chance to finish her strawberry shortcake. But she survived. Just one other thing. I think that you may, as a family, you may want to thank me for something that I'm not sure that you're aware of. You might. Did y'all know that Larry was contemplating on buying a restaurant? Did y'all know that? Cody, you didn't know that? Larry called me. Mr. Davis, I want you to come and walk to this restaurant with me. I'm thinking about buying a restaurant. So I met him on a Saturday morning. It was the one that had been closed. And he was telling me about this place. He wanted to open it up, and I walked through it with him. What do you think? What do you think? Larry, restaurant's a hard business. If this is what you want to do, but I wouldn't do it. And I never, I don't know whether that had anything to do with it, but he didn't buy that restaurant. And I said, you may want to thank me because did you know who gets to work in family restaurants? Family. I've probably spared y'all of doing that. I said, I know what Max, Justin would have been doing. They would have been washing dishes and cooking and everything else. And Cody, you would have been making strawberry shortcakes for somebody else. And I know what, now I know what Marty would have been doing. Marty would have been saying, okay, y'all need to go to work. But she would have been the boss. So anyway, if you did not know that, I mentioned it to Max. But if you did not know that, that's a true story. You can thank me later for keeping him from buying the family restaurant. Guys, I'm glad that you allowed me to be here. I'm going to take my seat. At home, in my home congregation, I'm commonly known as a man of just a few words. Isn't that right, preacher? Is that right? Well, don't. He's just playing. He knows that. Thank you, guys. Love your family. Thank you for giving me a chance.
Good afternoon, everyone. Hey, Billy and I were playing a game of straws to see who would back or go behind Sherelle. I told him it wasn't going to be me. Also, Mr. Williams, I understand Max gave you a note to keep it short here. He had the audacity to tell me to practice my talking points before I got up here. I'm here to tell you, Max, I didn't practice a thing. I'm shooting it from the hip, in the words of my father-in-law, shooting it from the hip. On October 18th, 2003, I had the wonderful, wonderful experience of meeting a beautiful lady. She was gorgeous, still gorgeous, sexy. Well, her name was Courtney Hargrove at the time. Beautiful woman. We met at San Marcos in Southwest Texas. After a step show of all things, we met there. Now, beautiful woman. So after we met, we exchanged numbers that day, and we talked for a good little while before we went on our first date. And in our conversations, my wife would tell me the jobs that she had. Now, my wife was a teacher. She was working at the Boys and Girls Club, working at Macy's, and the women's shelter, if I'm not mistaken. I'm like, what in the Jamaicanism is this? What is going on? Are you working for the cartel? What's happening? I didn't know what was going on. First, we had that many jobs. I was a first. So I felt that, okay, let me tell you some of my things. I've been working since I was 9 years old. I was picking up bottles. I don't know if any of you would know about that. That's picking up bottles you would turn in for the, okay, never mind. I was picking up bottles, turning them in, raking yards, mowing, and I'm from Georgia, about us to Georgia. So I used to go to the watermelon field, and used to throw some watermelon at age 9. And she said, well, I've been working since I was 5. I said, oh, but in my head, I'm like, you lying. Then I said it out right, you lying. Kind of believe that was true. Larry, Mr. Hargrove had her working at Chili's at the age of 5. I said, let me get CPS on the phone right now, because I know that ain't legal. I know that can't be legal. Some laws against that, child labor laws. I know there is. But she's been working since she was 5. So as I continue to know her, I continue to learn him before I even met him. And as a, and through her, she explained to me the different things that he had. He was a business owner, a songwriter, performer, civil rights activist, all these different things. I'm like, well, that's where you get it from. What in the Jamaicanism is this? Now, a few weeks go by again, we're conversing on the phone. So before I make my way up to Austin, Texas, I was stationed in San Antonio at the time. So before I make my way up to Austin, Texas, I'm preparing for our date. First date. First date. This is in November. Preparing for our first date. Now the house I went to wasn't in 23. Now, this is the Tortoise Lane area in Round Rock. So I get to the house, and the first thing I see is these two big gold lion statues sitting out in front of the door. Then I knew something was about to go down. Now, who has two big gold lion statues in front of the door? I know it had to be different here. Hanging around the Hargroves is different. For those of you that know, hanging around the Hargroves is different. Now, I could leave it at that, but I'm not going to leave it at that. Hanging around them is something all within itself. All right, but I'm going to keep it PG. I'm going to keep it, but do the best I can. Keep it PG. Now, again, I'm preparing for my first date with this delectable young lady. I'm ready, I'm snatched, I'm prepped. I got my wave cap on, have my wave cap on all day, make sure my waves are good to go. Sit my stuff to dry cleaners, shine my shoes and all that. I was ready. But what she didn't prepare me for, she didn't prepare me for Mr. Hargrove. I almost cursed. I almost said another S word. Instead of something. She didn't prepare me for Mr. Hargrove. Now, I want to say this. Let me take a pause. I want to say this. My wife was the first person I dated that had a strong male figure in the household. Not because I was looking for someone that didn't have a father figure in the house, just because that just seemed to be an absence of that. So I put this message out there. Man, if you have kids, daughter, son, or daughter, make sure that you are a strong male figure for that child. And that's one thing I would say Mr. Hargrove was, and is, and I'll touch more on that later. But again, my wife didn't prepare me for Mr. Hargrove. So as I get to the house, I prep for everything except for him. Now, he was a great conversationalist. Now, as we sat there, we met Mrs. Hargrove. She was warm and welcoming. I said, oh, man, this is beautiful. This is beautiful, met the brothers. This is beautiful. I'm not sure if Corey was there or not. Corey used on his own thing. I noticed that then. Now, with Mr. Hargrove, as we had our breakthrough, I sat down for a few minutes and a few minutes only. And then he was heading upstairs to the office. And he said, young man, you coming with me? Now, I didn't know if that was a question or a statement. It seemed at the moment that I didn't have the opportunity to say no. So I got up and I went upstairs. Now, I think Mr. Hargrove, he questioned me on our age difference. Now, I'm gonna touch on something after that. He questioned me on our age difference once we got up there in that office, and he gave me the business. Now, I'm not gonna say everything that he said to me that day between me and Mr. Hargrove, but he gave me the business. Now, and he asked me where was I gonna take my wife at. I told him, I said, we're gonna go to the Cheesecake Factory. So he gave me some little notes here and there. Then he said, you bringing her home tonight? And I didn't know if that was a question or a statement. So I made sure that I brought my we didn't divert from the plan. I had to get her back to Tortoise Lane ASAP after we ate some Cheesecake Factory. But I knew from that point, that this man loved his family. That was just from that snippet, that this man loved his family. And here I am, and I had the audacity to come try to take his baby girl out on a date. Now, we fast forward, just a little bit, still on the same day. As we get through the particulars and the preliminary up there upstairs in his office, we go back downstairs, and Courtney and I are about to leave. Now, as we're about to leave, Ms. Hargrove said, well, let me get a picture of y'all. I said, okay, I'm on this one, it's good graces now. That's what I'm thinking. I'm in this good grace now. I'm glad we smoothed things out a little bit. So we stood in front of the limo. We stood in front of the limo. We took our Nasdaq picture, our first day picture, which we still have today. Now, unbeknownst to me, I thought he was taking a picture of us. No, he was taking a picture of me. He wanted to make sure he had a record just in case I messed up. Somewhere along the line, because here I am coming to take his baby girl out on a date. And the messed up part of it was, again, I had just came from Hawaii. So I still had Hawaii plates on my car. So he wasn't playing with me. So he got a close-up of my face. I'm surprised he didn't ask for my driver's license. But I thought at the time it was a picture of us to get into memorialize our first date. Now fast forward a couple of years. This is in 2006. I give Mr. Hargrove, and I ask Mr. Hargrove for my wife's hand in marriage. For my wife's hand in marriage. And again, on that day, he gave me a lot of wisdom, a lot of knowledge. Now, throughout the years, he always gave you those gems. He dropped those jewels on you that you got to pay attention to. He dropped those jewels on you, and the things that'll help you out and guide you through life. So he gave me some great pointers on what to do and what not to do in order to make things right. Because I say this, my wife looks like her mother, but she acts like her father. I said, what in the trickery is this? All in my head, I'm thinking I'm getting a Marjorie Jr. And somebody been tripping and gave me a damn Larry Jr. Let's keep it from cursing. What in the shizzles? Boy, I was shocked and amazed at the same time. Shocked and amazed how something like that could happen. But anywho, it was too late to back out now. It's too late to back out now. So that, he gave me some great jewels, some great gems, and gave me some direction on what to do and what not to do. And I'm thankful to him for that. Why? Because I didn't have that. I didn't have that. I was one of those young men who grew up without a father in the home, same parent. And my mother did her best to wear both hats. But again, that's a trying thing, trying task for a lot of young women, a lot of women in the audience, in our world, period, to do that. So I didn't have what you guys had. And I know you appreciate it. Why? Because in the short time that I spent, when I say a short time, I know it was years, the short time I spent with them, that was something I wished I had, and something that I longed for, and that he came along and filled that part for me. And I was already in my 30s, and he filled that part for me. Now there are some things, my pigheadedness, I tell you this, my pigheadedness, some things I didn't want to accept. Because in my head, man, I'd have been about 9-10 countries. Ain't nothing you can tell me, but yeah, man, shut that up, Trent. That man gave me a lot of great information, showed me a lot of love, and some things today that I still do, because that is how he guided and directed me. And I'm appreciative of that. Now, a lot of people came up here today, and they said some things, and I don't want to be redundant. They said a few things, and they took some of the things that I may have said. I guess I should have talked this one, some talking points back, some things I should have said. But I'm going to go back to our first group outing as a family. Our first group outing. Now we go to Seguin, Texas Lutheran, Maxie School. He was playing football. Now this is when I knew the durability of Mr. Hargrove from that day. So we're all sitting as a family watching Max play, playing a game of football out on the field. Mr. Hargrove standing up on the bleacher. Next thing I know, Mr. Hargrove done fell about 3-4 rows down. I had to look on his feet to see if he was wearing some Stacey Adams. But he fell about 3-4 rows down. And now, I'm a former medic in Army, so the first responder, he wanted to jump up and help. But I first looked at the family, and ain't nobody budge. Maybe they knew something I didn't know in that quick time frame. But I know he busted his butt, I'll tell you. But he jumps up. Don't try this at home, folks. That's when I knew he was something different. This man is something different. So everybody has their own little story to tell, but that one right there always sticks with me. I said, what in the Joe Blow just happened? Now that is a few of a many of the things of the experiences that has taken place with Mr. Hargrove that I would cherish forever, because the man was in the class all by himself. Not trying to pump his, trying to air him up or do anything. I didn't wish anybody else would do that. He's in the class all by himself, and I say that he had filled that void that even in your manhood that you never knew that you really needed, that I needed. And he filled that void for me. He became that father figure. I can't say bonus father. I used that term, bonus father. I mean, I already had one, he would be a plus one. To me, that was him. That was my father figure. He was all I've known as far as I was. So I had big brothers, but not to that degree of what I saw and how he took care of his family. That was a father figure to me. That was a father figure to me. And he gave me a lot of gems. I would call him. He gave me a lot of gems. Sometimes he'd be on the job, or he'd be doing this or that, but he'll call me back. But I loved the man. The man was a great man in my eyes because of the things that he provided for me. And again, I'm not talking about material, man. I just mean knowledge. And just giving me some great tools and things that I did not have. And on the business side of the house, I was thinking about business one day. On the business side of the house, sitting in this office again, on the business side of the house, oh man, true business, true, hit to the core, true guy. I'll say this. Someone called, wanted to rent a limousine for the day. Now, I'm just sitting there listening, trying to take in notes, seeing what he's doing, some mental notes, not writing things down, taking notes, see how he handled business. Now, as he's going through the conversation with the person who's looking to rent a vehicle, in my head, I'm saying, I know that guy can't be on the phone still, because here Mr. Hargrove is telling him what he ain't going to do. Now, if you spend money on something, you should be able to do what you want to do, right? At least that's the intent of it all. So the guy telling Mr. Hargrove, well, I'd like to take a ride around here, we're just going to ride around. He said, we ain't going to do that. We're going from point A to point B. Anything you see, you're going to see in between point A and point B. In my head, I'm like, man, I would have hung up and called somebody else. But the guy continued to ask questions. No, we ain't doing that either. And at the end of the day, I'm thinking, I know this guy gonna hang up. I'll be dog if he ain't get the credit card number. reserved that vehicle. But I tell you, the man was multifaceted. The man is just a wonderful person to me. And I'm thankful for the time that I spent with him. I'm thankful for the things that he's shown me and the love that he's given to us. And you guys were truly blessed to have that. Not because I didn't, you know, it coming up, but you were truly blessed to have that, because for the small portion that I was allowed to be around, it just amazes me what could have happened if I was that guy who he reared from the beginning. And I'm thankful. I thank y'all for sharing it with me. I love y'all to death, and you just don't know how glad and how grateful I am to have met him and to be a part of his family. I thank you.
Ups and downs and crazy turnarounds. There's one woman that has been constant in my life. And I told her one time, if I were you, I would have left me long time ago. But she's so special, I wrote a song about her. Is that all right? It'd rather be fitting for Valentine's Day. I wrote a song called I Love You, Babe. I'm gonna ask my wife to come here. Come here, Margie. She's the best thing that ever happened to me in my life. Hey, oh, I swear I love you, darling. been a good mother for my children. You've been a good woman ever since I met you. My life is so happy because of you. What more, darling, can I do? 'Cause you're the one who stayed by me. You opened my eyes, and right now I can see. I love you, babe. Babe. Oh, I swear I love you, babe. I got one more thing I want to say about you, babe. Yeah, 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 yeah. I got one more thing I want to say right here. If y'all don't mind, this is personal. Many outside women tried to break us up, but you stayed with me when the times got tough. No other woman can please me now. I love you, darling, and oh, Larry ain't gonna go nowhere. Every morning when I rise, oh, I thank God that you're by my side. I love you, babe. Babe, oh, I swear I love you, babe. I love you, babe. Babe, I swear I love you, babe. Oh, girl, dance with me, say. Oh, it makes me strong. And I must say, honey, I love your smile. And that's why old Larry ain't gonna go nowhere. Every morning when I rise, oh, I thank God that you're by my side, babe. I love you, mama. Hey, 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 baby. I love you, baby. Oh, you mean the world to me. I love you, baby. Honey, we've been down through the years. We've laughed together. We've cried together. I love you, baby. I don't know if anybody out there know what I'm talking about. If you've ever been in love before, you ought to know what I don't mean and say, I want to thank y'all for being patient with me.
Well, this is some kind of program. And this time, we're supposed to have a tribute from the grandchildren. So, Max is on you now to take over.
Hi, name's MJ. Today we gather here to remember one of the most kind, generous, and forgiving men in my life, my grandfather, Poppy. Poppy always would share his ice cream with me and my brothers, and would give us Coke, Sprite, and Dr. Pepper, although we would always be fighting and trusting him out. For my 10th birthday, he gave me this very expensive collectible, which was one of the last I needed to finish my collection. When me and my brothers fought, he would always tell our dad. And at first, we thought that his only concern was because he did not want his stuff broken. But all I had to do was look into his eyes and know that it was because he truly cared. Back when I was little, he would go to the store and give me Round Rock donuts while I was sitting with Granny on the couch drinking milk. And when Papa came back, I would only eat the orange donuts, aka glazed donuts. A while back, Granny and Poppy had this weird lamp with these glass and gem things hanging off of it. I would always sneak and break them right off. One day, Poppy saw me, was not even angry, but just said, "Don't do that. You don't want to break it." I cannot even begin to express how much I miss Poppy already. And when I think about it too much, all I have to do is remember that he's in a better place now. I'd go on all day talking about how much I loved him, but instead, I'm going to stand up straight and hold my head up high and be a good boy like Poppy would have wanted me to, knowing that he will always have a very special place in my heart. Thank you.
Hello.
I am the oldest grandchild and was the only grandchild for a little bit until they came along. I was just so close with my Poppy. It was just always me and him, you know, us working and cleaning the buildings, going to the studio together, and just always hanging out. But I have this little tribute that I wrote for him that I'm gonna read to y'all if y'all don't mind. My dearest Poppy, I still can't believe I even have to write this. To me, I've always seen you as Superman himself, just invincible. Nothing or no one could take you from me. Since I was a little girl, we always had a one-of-a-kind bond. You were always just my Poppy, supported and loved me through it all. I'll never forget the first time we went to the studio. I had to be about 5 or 6. And you put me in that booth and I didn't know nothing about singing. We couldn't even use the track. Then I was 8 and I had my first violin concert. And when I came off that stage, you was the first one to ask for violin lessons. And boy, did I, he sounded so bad on there. I can't lie, I'm really broken, knowing that I won't be able to hear your sweet voice anymore. And it pains me, but I'm happy, just because I know you're singing your heart out with the greats up there, and I can only imagine how amazing it is. This I know what it feels like goodbye, because I can't see you or hug you, but I remind myself that you're waiting for me on the other side, and that your spirit is always with me. I'm going to miss you telling me stories about your good old days from back in the day and those random life lessons. But I love you so much, Poppy. Love, miss you. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm Lauren Roberson. I am the granddaughter of Larry Hargrove, but also known as Poppy, Dad, Husband, or Brother. We are all here today to say our last goodbyes to him. Poppy was a very good person. He made a lot of marks in this world. As Poppy lays there peacefully in heaven, he's looking down on us. He was fun to be around, and he told funny jokes and made us laugh. He always told us that he loved us, and we always told him that we loved him back. Poppy was in a lot of pain because of his sickness, but now he's with God. Now he can run, jump, and swim, and no more sickness. He has done a lot of good things and seen a lot. And I hope to experience some of the wonderful things that Poppy did. You will be missed, and I'll always love him.
I'm Soraya Rogers. I'm the niece of Max Hargrove and Samara Hargrove. Poppy Hargrove always treated me like I was his own grandchild, whether I was their niece or not. And this song is called Gone Too Soon by Michael Jackson, and this song is for him.
Join me and join this family some love for this awesome, awesome celebration of the life for Larry so we all know that this is not easy. And protocol haven't been established, but I will acknowledge Pastor McClendon, St. James Church, for officiant, Mr. Williams, to all the clergy, everybody that's in the house, Margie, you love that dude, Dad. I know Larry, I remember, because I've been around the Hargrove and connected families for just a little bit. And Larry had always had this special look in his eye when he looked at Margie when he was younger. And I used to laugh because that the only other time I saw that look was when he was singing. And he was doing that. Now, I go back because the tradition of singing in the Hargrove family, all the way back to church in the country. Rise this cross. Okay, y'all don't know what I'm talking about, but anyway, it's there. And it was, yeah, a tradition of singing. And I found out, though, that we were there. I didn't know the whole church was family. Everybody at the church there was family, I remember, you know. And I didn't come. My family is in Arkansas. So the family we had here is real small. I became a big part, or should I say a part of, the Hargrove family. But there's a richness that is there because I remember that his father, music and guitar, he loved his wife. He loved his kids. Everybody worked in the Hargrove family. No, listen to me. Because the richness, right, of working as a family with an entrepreneurial spirit was something that was always there. And they would recruit anybody they could to work in any of the many, my brother said, what the Jamaican stuff is this? My daddy taught me how to work. But Larry and they taught me how to work fast. Bowling alley, office, restaurants, anybody else out there how to clean? I knew how to work on the clock. As a matter of fact, I remember one time Roy and I went after the club. Don't sit there and act like you don't know what I'm talking about. After the club, we went to clean the restaurant because Larry had called and said we needed to go and clean the restaurant. What am I saying? There's a high energy, very high energy. And listen to me, legacy is what we have witnessed here. And legacy is not something that we talk about a whole lot, but it's already been done. Larry's eulogy has already been done. So I'm not standing to do his eulogy, you know? But the influence of his legacy is why we're here. We've seen it displayed in his children. We've seen the impact. And music, the love of his, I mean, just love music. I remember going to, with Larry, going to the house, but I was younger than him. And Larry, I couldn't pull off the James Brown look, so I grew the afro because I wanted to be like I went to Larry. Larry was smooth, but not smooth, S-M-O-O-T-H, S-M-O-O-V-E, smooth in everything that he did. Brilliant mind, you've already heard that, okay? But the thing that is amazing is that when you think of legacy, it didn't just come from Larry. It came from a set of values, a desire to be able to do something larger than life. And understanding that whatever you do, right, in life, that's your legacy. Legacy is not what you leave. Legacy is what you live. I saw it. I've been around this family. I've seen the love, but I've seen the love in hard times and difficult times, in lean times. Anybody can be around you when things are great, but when things are difficult and you have a lot of mouths to feed or you have a lot of things that need to be done, then that's when you instill the values that are what? That make a family strong.
I'm not talking about anybody being perfect. I'm talking about, though, that love covers a multitude of sins. Somebody didn't know what I'm talking about. We don't have enough of the celebrations like this. And there are too many times that we are mourning instead of celebrating. So I thank you for letting me to be able to stand here just for a few moments. Now, I did not, who was that? Somebody was talking about the blues or whatever, right? See, I didn't know what funk was until I met Larry. And when I met Larry, then I understood the funk, R&B, soul connection, you know, and Parliament became one of my favorite groups that I would do that. Boy, you know, we used to listen, and we're going to talk about state of mind anyway, we're going to leave it alone. And we used to have that, and I would listen to it. I'd never seen a limousine. I got to a limousine. We thought Larry was rich, just wealthy, just that he was just absolutely wealthy. But he was an image larger than life and inspired a lot of us. He really did. And many of them that were inspired by Larry, I'm not even here. The first guitar that I held in my hand is at Larry's house. It's bass guitar. I went home to play the bass guitar. Not good enough to hit the stage, but I played bass guitar in church. I did a lot of things. What am I saying? I was just blessed by him. But I understand that. And when I was thinking just in brevity about what to share today, because we can all tell all the great Larry stories, but the family has already done that. But I want to read this verse to you. It says, at about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying, singing songs to God, right? And the other prisoners listened. Suddenly there was a strong earthquake that shook the foundation of the jail. Then all the doors of the jail broke open. All the prisoners were freed from their chains. And the jailer woke up, saw that the jail doors were open. Thinking that the prisoners had already escaped, he got his sword and was about to kill himself. But Paul shouted, "Don't hurt yourself. We are all still here." The jailer told someone to bring a light. And then he ran inside and, shaking with fear, fell down before Paul and Silas. He brought them outside and said, "Men, what must I do to be saved?" And they said to him, "Believe in the Lord Jesus, you will be saved, you and all your people in your house." Amen? Acts chapter 16. And here's what I want to start about. Something about the music. Music, which is the what? Combination of tones that create a harmonious sound that blended together can touch the mind and the heart. Can be inspirational. It can bring any type of message. When done with vocals, then it is vocal music, which is, again, the blending of voices at various different ranges that brings back a harmonious sound that's pleasing to the ear. We are inspired by music. Anybody in here have a favorite song that you sing? Sometimes you got one for every feeling. When you're down, you got a song that lifts you up. When you're quiet, we got a song that we sing. I hum a song when I'm in a mood, and I go all day long, and I'm humming that song. That music does something about us. It is one of the most stable fine arts that is what? That designed to be able to help us deal with life. And life is not something we're supposed to do just randomly, but we're supposed to live life with purpose. We're supposed to live life that we want to be able to do what? Transfer. You can't live and enjoy your own life. How are you going to lead me into telling me what life really is? The dynamics of being a leader in a family is not something that's easy. That's one of the reasons why we have so many families that are not complete, not two-parent, that what? The absence of the father, right? Because God has designed us to have the input of both, because we have what? Both in us. When something is absent, that means that the harmony that's supposed to be made in the family is thrown off. So the music that comes out of that family is what? It's disconnected. It breaks down and creates a bad sound in the minds of children. So instead of learning what harmony is, they begin to be soloists but don't have the skills and the talent to navigate
life that you need, because when somebody doesn't direct me, that means I gotta get my sound from someplace else. So we complain about what the noise that's picked up from the street, but if I don't have anybody that's bringing any beautiful music in my home, then I gotta get that music from somewhere else. And so the bitterness of the street becomes the music that many of our kids hear. The image that you saw on the screen, right? It's not enough of that. And I'm not just talking about Larry as a performer. I'm talking about what you saw was the passing on of something by which the heart has attached itself. And when the heart attaches itself to something, that means love is in it. And when love is in it, the message resounds and breaks every barrier. Brings us to an understanding that when you talk about music, music is not just singing or playing, but music is when the mind and the body and the soul come together out of the vocal or the instrument, and you're feeling the very inside of the musician that's touching that instrument. It's a way to express what's inside of me that I may not even be able to talk about. You find out in moments of faith, music is something that heals us. I remember growing up, and you have what? All of the beautiful old hymns that we don't hear too much anymore. But I hear some beautiful music coming from some of our loved Christian artists and rappers that nobody's even listening to, because they have a message. God is still the same God, but he speaks to the generation around him using what? Music once again. Music has a way of effect. Now, I'm not good at singing, so I play instruments. And I ain't that good at instrumentation, so I speak. But when I speak in my mind between God and I, there is a rhythm that God plays in my mind to get me in sync with his thoughts, because I don't know what you need to hear, and then God brings it out. It's still music. Paul and Silas, in jail, in trouble, had been beaten unjustly, been now thrown into the dungeon, their feet put in stocks. In the stocks, the legs were separated to the point to where they were in extreme pain. The dampness and the coldness and the position, they were set there as a punishment for what? For speaking what they believed in their hearts. When we were growing up, and artists like Larry and others, they were speaking the heartbeat of what, of our community, of our people, that we didn't have an opportunity to say, but they were given a public platform to express our thoughts and our needs. Wasn't just singing, it wasn't just performing, it was talking about the things that we dealt with every day. And Larry could turn anything into a song. Where's my screwdriver? Bring me back my drill. Anyway, see, I get, you give him anything, he can do it. He's gifted, he's talented. And it's hard to be around somebody that's gifted and talented and not feel small. Larry wouldn't make you feel small. He was humble. Direct. Full of love. Nobody had come into the prison and sang. Because most people in the prison were there and being punished, and they what, took on the attitude of the prison. The surrounding atmosphere did not lend itself to being lifted up, but to drop their heads and be buried and be waiting on the next punishment or death. But Paul and Silas, after they had locked them down, they began to sing and began to praise God. Can I go here for a minute? If more of us would capture the spirit of a Larry Hargrove and sing out of our heart, it would resonate to our children.
Who sings when you're lonely and nobody says anything to comfort you? Who sings when your children need something to eat and nobody's brought any food? Who sings when the paycheck stops and you don't have any money? No sings. People that believe and know the music has the power. So what are you saying, Pastor Q? Music. Sing it. But I gotta leave you one more thing. I don't care how good a voice you have. I don't care how talented you are. I don't care how beautiful you are. I don't care if you can dance and shake it and drop it. I don't care if your heart is not in it, if it's not genuine, if it is not real, if it doesn't come from a real place, then nobody will hear it because you are not an artist. You are simply an entertainer. And God is tired of us entertaining folks. I gotta quit. Ready for us to do what? Sing out of the beauty of our hearts. When we sing out of the beauty of our hearts, watch what happened. When they sang, they were locked down. And somebody said an earthquake came. Couldn't explain it. And the cell door opened. And the stocks that were locked down came loose. And then Paul and Silas, instead of running, right, they stood that right there and waited because they knew what was going on. What am I saying? If we get the music in our spirit of truly exemplify what we believe, then we will have more celebrations of legacy and pass something on to our children that they can use after we go. Watch this. Because I want to see my children, when I'm walking down the streets of heaven, I want to see them coming in my direction. Not just you. Entertain. Know yourself. Change your household. You have done a marvelous job here today. Under difficult circumstances, but what you have shown is the power of legacy. Stop and think. What song are you singing? What music are you making? What is anybody going to benefit from your life? If all you're doing is just for you, then that's all you have when your time is through. But if what you do is for the benefit of your legacy, then you'll be able to hear the voices and see the actions long after this moment. Stay. Stay connected. Don't lose what you have. And to all of you that are here today, think of one thing. When you stop singing, will anybody take up your song and sing it after you're gone? God bless you and God keep you, and thank you for this opportunity to sing.
Beautiful, beautiful thoughts. We appreciate it so very much. At this time, the program will say final viewing, but I was told that there will be a love offering taken. I'm not certain who's going to work that out or coordinate that, but Brother Franklin, Franklin has it, so I'm understanding there will be a love offering. So, Barry, I'll turn it over to you.
I have to use this mic. The mic may have went on lunch break. Praise God. This has truly been a celebration for an awesome legend. Amen. Let's clap our hands for an awesome legend. Because we're still under the COVID. Don't y'all listen to what them other people saying. We're still under the rules and at the church. So therefore, we cannot do a
after service viewing. That's why I told you at the beginning. But as we go out, they have people with the plate. And let me make sure, because you know, sometimes we get things twisted and get the wrong message out. A love offering is being taken up to give to when Larry designed his whole service. Y'all hear the music he designed that, what he wanted, how he wanted it. And the best part, he chose the best undertaker that could carry out what he wanted. But now listen, all of this is paid for. He took care of that. So the love offering that you're sawing into is going to a cause that he believed in. It's not going to light celebration. The family has instructions by him of what to do with that offering there. So if you would dig deep and give, and if you're helping, you're not hindering. If you're hindering, you're not helping. Now, he's a legend, so we're going to do this a little different when we go to the cemetery. We're going to take the procession down 12th Street so the procession can pass by all the ways he used to go. Yeah, them limousine rides to y'all that halfway paid him and didn't. Pass by some of his relatives that's over at Evergreen Cemetery and go by those places. So that's what we're going to do. And when we get to the cemetery, we got some more of his music that we're going to play. And if you missed it, the folks ask you, you can go to the website and get the, I think it's a scan on the back of that program that they can scan the program and send it to you folks. And also on our website, you can go back and look at it over and over again. Thank you, Sister Linda Mayo, for the media. And Mr. Hicks. Now, when I get Mr. Hicks come to take these pictures, family, you're going to have thumb drives for each one of y'all of all the special moments. We kind of make these celebrations, family reunions there. It just didn't nobody bring a potato salad and left it in the back of the car for you to eat when it's over with, because you really will be running there. So as we get ready to go out, they're going to have folks down there to take up the offering at the door to be sure to give that. So we're ready to go. You can play that music.
Thank you. Here tonight, just as promised, all the way out of Austin, Texas, the Texas Songbird himself, Larry and Shannon Hargrove. Let's make him feel real welcome.
Must have been cold there in my shadow to never have sunlight on your face. You were content to let me shine. You always walked a step behind.
Bye.